Okay, good morning.
Hola.
All right, open, if you will, to Genesis chapter 1. We're going to be flipping around quite a bit. Genesis chapter 1. I'll be focusing this week primarily on, okay, for those of you that have been here, okay, you know that we're looking at just what the Bible says about being a biblical man or biblical female is. And then this week, I'm going to be looking primarily through, as far as a lot of what the layout in this book is. But we'll be looking at the woman's role first, and then from there we'll look at the men's role next week. And there's actually a lot. There's a lot for both. It's just it was easier for me to address the woman, I guess, first, and then the men afterwards, just because it's a lot more. But anyway, so Genesis chapter 1, and for those that haven't been, we've been looking at just what the Bible has to say about gender roles, and then just what the Bible says about biblical femininity, biblical masculinity. And then we've seen so far, week one, that we were created to work, and then that we were created to worship. Also, last week, we looked at that if we're going to be biblical male or female. Now, this applies to both. Now, this isn't just strictly for one or the other. That you're going to be pursuing holiness, and that we're supposed to develop integrity. We're supposed to have Bible integrity. So as a biblical man or a biblical woman, both apply in that you're supposed to have, or you're supposed to pursue Bible integrity, godly integrity. You're supposed to have holiness, develop holiness, pursue holiness. And then also we are created with the purpose to work, so we should be pursuing or be industrious. And then also we worship God. We're created for that purpose, to worship God. So some of this is going to be a little bit of an overlap of what I've already taught. Genesis 1, verse 28 says, God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. And then it says, if you... actually, just a little bit before it, that in verses 26 and 27, it says, God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image, and the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. Okay, so that's kind of important to look at. We go to chapter 2, verse 18, and it says, And the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make an help meet for him. Okay, a helper that is meet or appropriate for him. And out of the ground, the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air, and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called every living thing, that was the name thereof. And Adam gave names to all the cattle and all the fowl of the air, to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found an help meet for him. Okay, notice. Man was alone. Now he was placed in the garden, and he was given a task. Now mind you, this is before sin. And he needed help with that task. So God said, okay, it's not good for him to be alone. He's going to need a helper, and a helper that's suitable for him, basically. That's the word me. So he creates all these animals. And then it says of it, there's not, of those animals that were all created, there was not found an help that was suitable for him. Okay? So in other words, having a pet's nice, but that's not sufficient. Okay, for your companionship needs. And so he says, verse 21, and the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept, and he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh thereof. Instead, instead thereof, and then the rib which the Lord God had taken from the man made he a woman and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, now this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh, and she shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And then they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. So you have institution of marriage. Just reading from this. Okay, I knew who the actor was, and I knew that his character on the weekly primetime sitcom was a sleazy with a different woman every week womanizer. Though I had never seen the television program, nor do I intend to. What little I had caught from commercials during Sunday afternoon football had brought me to this obvious conclusions. Speaking of a TV show. And then a bombshell was dropped on me. The actor is actually a homosexual. The role he is playing for the sitcom does not reflect the person he is. Incidentally, his homosexuality does not reflect the person God made him either. God intends for what you are to be clearly connected to what you do. What you are is your identity. What you do is your role. Though male and female are equal in bearing God's image and in relation to God, they are not the same in function, responsibility, or role. That means though male and female are equal in relation to one another as being human and bearing God's image, God does not expect or desire them to do the same things in behavior toward one another and in fulfilling his creation mandate, be fruitful and multiply. The male has a role to play, the female has a role to play. These roles are different yet equally important in God's creation. Okay, the male and female are to play different roles in God's creation was evident from the beginning. The creation mandate and the fact that there are two parties involved in fulfilling it, male and female, point to the fact that each had a part to play. For example, the command, be fruitful, multiply, coupled with the fact that standing there were male and female requires that each play a different, distinct role in order to fulfill that command. One would father a child, and then one would bear the child. Some claim that male headship is a result of the curse, but the curse is actually further proof as to the distinct roles God intended for male and female from the beginning. Sin did not destroy God's intent for creation, but it did mar that intent. The joy of childbirth, something assigned to the woman by the sheer nature of her anatomy, would be marred by pain and sorrow. The joy of her assisting relationship to the man would be marred by the strife of desiring to subdue him. The joy of work associated with providing for the family would be marred by sweat and difficulty. Each of these curses corresponds to the original creation mandate to be fruitful and multiply and to subdue the earth and have dominion. Okay, God's curse for each reflected the marring that sin had brought to their distinctive roles. What are the roles that God intended and intends for male and female then? Okay, so you would have male as the leader, male as a provider, but we'll be looking at that for next week. And then for this week, we would have female as the helper, and then female as caregiver. There's going to be more that we're going to be looking at with regard to this as well. But this is just looking at it just from analyzing Genesis 1 and what his original intent was in the design. So when he had created them, he had put them in the garden. This is before the fall, and then this is before sin had come into play. So as originally intended, she was supposed to be a helper. Okay, just as the male role can be described with the words leader and provider, the female role can be described with the words helper and caregiver. Female as the helper. The whole creation of the woman surrounds the search of a suitable helper, a helpmeet for Adam. But for Adam there was not found an helpmeet for him. And skip down, and then the rib which the Lord God had taken from the man made he a woman and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh, and she shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Okay, Adam could not fulfill God's intended purpose for mankind by himself. No member of the animal kingdom was compatible. Another male would not have sufficed. It was a woman who fulfilled his role of a helper meet or fitting or suitable for Adam. The New Testament reaffirms this connection for the female role. In 1 Corinthians 11, 8 and 9, okay, for the man is not of the woman, but the woman of the man, and neither was the man created for the woman, but the woman for the man. Okay, the female role is that of a helper, especially in relation to a male. According to the Bible, a female fulfills her God-given responsibility by submitting to the headship of the male and by assisting him in carrying out God's creation mandate. In this way, she is a helper. This is a great paradox. Male-female equality and male headship, female submission. Man and woman are equal as human beings, but they are not equal in their role. Feminists wrongly assume that they are submissive roles, or that the submissive role equals inferiority, but a woman is no more inferior in her role as a helper than God is when he fulfills the role of helper in our lives, or Jesus, who came not to be ministered unto, but to minister, was in his. Okay. As a helper, a woman should assist a man in his God-given role as a leader by respectfully offering opinions, suggestions, and recommendations in the decision-making process, by supporting his final decision, and by doing what she can at home or at work to support his position in the workplace or in the community. Now, this is as a helper suitable, and this is addressing again the original intent or original design. The way Peter puts it is that the woman, the word in the King James is weaker, but it means delicate, the more delicate vessel. Okay, so in other words, the men are supposed to dwell with their wives according to knowledge. And let me go turn here so I don't butcher it. The intent behind it was that their prayers be not hindered. They're not supposed to have strife of married couples, not supposed to have a division in their relationship, because what happens is that the prayers are going to be hindered. If
1 Peter 3? Is that what you're looking for?
Yes. Actually... Yeah, okay, verse 7. 1 Peter 3, 7. Likewise, ye husbands, dwell with him according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel. Okay? And as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers be not hindered. Alright, so the husband, in this case, the wife is called here the weaker vessel. Literally, it's the more delicate vessel. As far as she's not lower, but she is different. I mean, that's just plain and simple. She's created differently, has a different anatomy, has a different way of thinking. And then he's commanded, he's supposed to dwell according to knowledge. And so that means the husband's supposed to learn his wife. Okay, she's not, you know, you got to learn them. You have to study them. You have to take the time to be able to go ahead and communicate effectively, so that you would know her, her needs, her wants, her hopes, aspirations, and those kinds of things. And then you're supposed to give honor unto them, as unto the weaker vessel. In other words, they're held in high esteem, and they're supposed to be regarded highly, because they're more delicate than what the man would be. Okay, so as a woman, primarily the role is that they've been given would be as, first off, as a helper. That was God's original intent. And then now he comes in and he says as a caregiver. Okay, as we mentioned earlier, the curses of Genesis 3 make sense in the context of God's original intent for each gender. And unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. In God's directive to woman, he made plain that her responsibility is that of a wife and a mother. Her suitability for the male corresponds to her being a wife. Her childbearing correlates to her being a mother. Though the male is ultimately responsible for the teaching and training of the children, according to Ephesians 6:4, The female engages in instructing and guiding them also while keeping the house. I will therefore, and this is 1 Timothy 5:14, I will therefore that the younger women marry, bear children, guide the house, give none occasion to the adversary to speak reproachfully. In Titus 2, 4, and 5, teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. Okay, God's intended arena for the woman is the home, because that is where the children are. So what about Proverbs 31? Isn't the virtuous woman a working woman? Yes, the caregiver aspect of the female role does not prohibit her working outside the home. In fact, the Proverbs 31 passage has the woman's responsibility to her family fully in view. In Proverbs 31, 12, she will do him, speaking of her husband, good and not evil all the days of her life. She's not afraid, in verse 21, same chapter, she is not afraid of the snow for her household, for all her household are clothed with scarlet. Verses 27 through 28, the same chapter, she looketh well to the ways of her household and eateth not the bread of idleness. Her children arise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praiseth her. The Proverbs 31 woman has a virtuous character in part because she faithfully fulfills her role as caregiver to her family. Okay, Ruth is an example of a widow or single lady working outside of the home for the benefit of her family, quote unquote, in this case, Naomi. This is Ruth chapter 2, verses 2 and 3. Ruth chapter 2, verse 8 indicates that Boaz had other maidens or single ladies gleaning in his field as well, basically workers that he had employed. The central question is, how does working outside the home contribute to a woman's fulfilling her role as a caregiver to her family? Now, mind you, this is obviously primarily speaking to what would be married. We'll address the singleness aspect in a bit here, actually. And that's primarily 1 Corinthians 7. Okay, as a caregiver, a woman should tend to children by providing protection, instruction, and guidance in the husband's absence, and should seek to wholly satisfy her husband emotionally, socially, and physically. Some may argue that the helper caregiver role of the female applies only to a wife because the woman God created was a wife to Adam. We must understand that the creative intent for woman as a helper caregiver applies to the female gender. Even Lawrence Summers, he's basically like a what? Two things. He's not a Bible teacher, but he was head of Harvard, if I'm not mistaken. Not a believer, but he was just a president of Harvard for a while, and then he, as an unbeliever, he acknowledged God's design. Is basically why he's relating him. Relayed the story of his daughter who, when given two trucks for her playtime, imagined one as daddy truck and the other as baby truck. The giving of care is a natural expression of the female gender. Okay, 1 Corinthians 14 testifies as well that the headship of man and the submission of woman transcend the marriage relationship. They are innate to the female gender. Okay, 1 Corinthians 14, 34 to 35, let your women keep silence in the churches, for it is not permitted unto them to speak, but they are commanded to be under obedience, as also saith the law. And if they will learn anything, let them ask their husbands at home, for it is a shame for a woman to speak in the church. This is not a blanket command for women to stop talking in church gatherings. It's not a prohibition against women giving a testimony in mixed company. Something was going on during the assembling of the Corinthian church that undermined male headship and female submission. As with many other activities in the Corinthian worship service, Paul was correcting them on it. Whereas a man's mistreatment of women and children contradicts his role as leader provider, a woman's disrespect towards a man and the neglect of children contradict her role as helper caregiver. Though, as with the male, age and marital status will dictate how it is practically carried out, the female role is a helper caregiver. All right, I know it's kind of like a lengthy part. Does anybody have any questions so far on? No. All right, go to 1 Corinthians 7. Now, concerning the things whereof ye wrote unto me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. Okay, nevertheless, to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife, and let every woman have her own husband. Okay, and then, now, once they're already married, okay, let the husband render unto the wife due benevolence, and the like, and likewise also the wife unto the husband. The wife hath not power over her own body, but the husband, and likewise also the husband hath not power of his own body, but the wife. Okay, defraud ye not one another. One the other, except it be with consent for a time, that you may give yourselves to fasting and prayer, and come together again, that Satan tempt you not for your incontinency. But I speak this by permission and not of commandment. For I would that all men were even as I myself. This is Apostle Paul speaking to the church at Corinth, and now addressing, in particular, this is a change from what he had been addressing them before. He had been addressing them about division, and then he addressed them in particular about the fornication that had been going on. And so now he changes and he addresses another question. It doesn't specify what the question was, but we can pretty much conjecture that it had to do with marriage and being single. Because that's how he starts it off with when he's addressing it here at the beginning of the chapter. And then he says, I would that all men were even as myself, which was single. He wasn't married. He didn't have anybody with him. But every man hath his proper gift of God, one after this manner and another after that. I say therefore to the unmarried and widows, it is good for them if they abide even as I. But if they cannot contain, let them marry, for it is better to marry than to burn. And to the married I command ye, yet not I, but the Lord, let not the wife depart from her husband. And if she depart, let her remain unmarried, or be reconciled to her husband, and let not the husband put away his wife. But to the rest I speak, not the Lord. If any brother hath a wife that believeth not, and she be pleased to dwell with him, let him not put her away. And the woman which hath an husband that believeth not, and if he be pleased to dwell with her, let her not leave him. For the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband. Elsewhere your children unclean, but now are they holy. But if the unbelieving depart, let him depart. A brother or sister is not under bondage in such cases, but God hath called us to peace. For what knowest thou, O wife, whether thou shalt save thy husband, or knowest thou, O man, whether thou shalt save thy wife? But as God hath distributed to every man, as the Lord hath called every one, so let him walk, and so ordain I in all churches. Is any man called being circumcised, let him not become uncircumcised. Is any called in uncircumcision, let him not be circumcised. Okay, circumcision is nothing, and uncircumcision is nothing but the keeping of the commandments of God. Okay, let every man abide in the same calling wherein he was called. Art thou called being a servant? Care not for it. If thou mayest be made free, use it rather. For he that is called in the Lord being a servant is the Lord's free man. Likewise, also he that is called being free is Christ's servant. Ye are bought with a price. Be not ye the servants of men. And then, brethren, let every man wherein he is called there and abide with God. So he's addressing, now he's gonna address a little bit more of what I was wanting to talk about for this, but just so we get just clarification or whatever. Where you're called, okay, if you're married, don't seek to be divorced. If you're single, then if God's called you to that, praise the Lord. In other words, focus on serving God. Don't consume yourself, or don't preoccupy yourself with what your marital status is. The focus should be the Lord, is really what it is. So wherever you've been called, in other words, were you born again as somebody that was married? Okay, well, praise the Lord for that. If you're born again as somebody that was single, well, praise the Lord for that. Regardless of whatever your marital status is, the fact is that you're God's. Now that you're born again, you're God's, so serve the Lord. Don't focus on men and those things. And then he speaks in particular to those that were single, in that he addressed it a little bit earlier, but he's getting ready to talk a little bit more about now, is that, now granted, this was by permission, not by commandment, but he says it is, and he's going to address this more now, it is good for you to remain single. And that is because some of what he's going to talk of now is that if you're single, you could give full attention to the Lord, whereas if you're married, then you have to give attention. That's not a bad thing, obviously, to give attention to your spouse. But the fact is, it feels almost like as if it's a divided focus. And it isn't, because the thing is, God's intent was for marriage. And now, okay, let's continue on. Verse 25, now concerning virgins, I have no commandment of the Lord, yet I give my judgment as one that hath obtained mercy of the Lord to be faithful. Okay, I suppose therefore that this is good for the present distress. I say that it is good for man to be so. In other words, unmarried. Okay, art thou bound unto a wife? Seek not to be loosed. Art thou loosed from a wife? Seek not a wife. And if thou marry, thou hast not sinned. Okay, so it's not wrong to sin. It's not wrong to desire to be married. It's not wrong for those things. Okay, that's how we're created. And if a virgin marry, she hath not sinned. Nevertheless, such shall have trouble in the flesh, but I spare you. Okay, so in other words, there's going to be a measure of difficulty there. But this I say, brethren, the time is short. It remaineth that both they that have wives be though as they had none, and they that weep as though they wept not, and they that rejoice as though they rejoice not, and they that buy as though they possess not. And they that use this world as not abusing it, for the passion of this world passeth away. But I would have you without carefulness, or no, without worry, without anxious, without anxiety. He that is unmarried careth for the things that belong to the Lord, how he may please the Lord. But he that is married careth for the things that are of the world, how he may please his wife. There is a difference also between a wife and a virgin. The unmarried woman careth for the things of the Lord, that she may be holy both in body and in spirit. But she that is married careth for the things of the world, how she may please her husband. And this I speak for your own profit, not that I may cast a snare upon you, but for that which is comely or appropriate, and that ye may attend unto the Lord without distraction. Okay. But if any man think that he behaveth himself uncomely or inappropriately toward his virgin, if she pass a flower of age and need so require, let him do what he will. He sinneth not, let them marry. So, okay, so again, it's not wrong to marry. Nevertheless, he that standeth steadfast in his heart, having no necessity, but hath power over his own will, and hath so decreed in his heart that he will keep his virgin, doeth well. So then, he that giveth her in marriage doeth well, but he that giveth her not in marriage doeth better. And he only says that from the perspective of the fact that you can give more attention to serving the Lord because you don't have the extra responsibility. In other words, you don't have all the stuff that comes with marriage. So you're able to. It's not wrong. It's not bad. It's just use it. Use it to how he says it. How he stated it earlier in the chapter. It's something that's not just well, obviously well pleasing to the Lord, but it's something that it's take advantage of it. Take advantage of your singlehood. Okay, so the wife is bound by the law as long as her husband liveth, but if her husband be dead, she is at liberty to be married to whom she will, only in the Lord. But she is happier if she so abide after my judgment. I think also that I have the Spirit of God. All right, so role. You say, okay, if I'm going to remain single, then how can I be a helper and caregiver at that point, since I won't have... that'd be my question. I'd think, okay, if I'm created to be a helper, as far as according to original intent or according to original design, a helper and a caregiver, how do I fulfill that then as a single person?
Serving God.
Yeah. You do it in your service to the Lord. And that is also, by the way, when in the local church, go to Titus chapter 2. And then we're going to look at 1 Timothy also. And then we'll look at 1 Peter again. We'll start at just the beginning of the chapter so we get established the context. But speak thou the things which become sound doctrine, or in other words, that are befitting healthy doctrine, healthy teaching. And here is the purpose for that. That the aged men be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, and charity, and patience. Same thing, now he's addressing the women. It says, the aged women likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness. Okay, now he's going to describe what that looks like. All right, so in other words, the teaching that we would receive from pastor or from spiritual leadership in the church is supposed to be sound doctrine, or befitting that which is sound doctrine. So sound doctrine is going to have fruit, or it's going to have a product to it, and this is what it's supposed to look like, okay? This is the effect it's supposed to have in our lives. Our behavior, it says in particular as far as the women, that that which is appropriate to holiness becometh holiness, okay? And here's how it looks like specifically. It says, not false accusers, okay? So they're not going to be gossiping. They're not going to be liars. Okay, not given to much wine. And then teachers of good things. Now, what's a good thing? That's pretty broad. Basically, anything that's... He assumes we know what good means, what good is. But basically, that's pretty broad. Anything that's good, anything that would be beneficial, healthily, spiritual, helpful to you. So, you are created to be able to influence, in particular the older women, those that are not just younger, but also of your peers, and I would say even older than you. So, God's desire and intent for you is to communicate, to teach. Also verse 4, that the women are that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children. And then he goes on, discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. Okay. Younger women, now obviously there's going to be a distinction in age here. Young people and older people have a lot of differences, obviously. I mean, physically, you don't have the strength or abilities that you would have when you're older. A lot of times, you know, our bodies are breaking down and such, illnesses. But also, there's an outlook. There's when you're younger, you don't usually see the bigger picture unless you're taught, you're trained. So you have to be trained in what is right. And so God makes provision for that, in that those that are older, or at least God's pattern, God's design, is to influence and instruct the younger into what they should know, because God's will for them is that they do right, and they be right, they end up right. Part of that is that they're created, says here, that they to be sober, okay? They're clear-headed in their thinking. All right, so they're not consumed with foolishness. So somebody that's sober-minded is going to be focused on that which is important, which is right, on godly things. Okay, they're love their husbands and love their children. If you're single, then obviously you don't have to worry about that, but you should be loving your brethren, because that is something that is very clearly commanded to all believers. And then you're supposed to have a love for the brethren, a love for the lost. Okay, to be discreet, chaste, and then keepers at home. Okay, discreet and chaste. So you're not going to be drawing attention to yourself. First Peter actually gives a better description of this. Not that this is a bad description, but he addresses it in that, discreet, chaste, and keepers at home, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. So the way you carry yourself will bring either negative reproach, or it'll bring positive towards the word of how the word of God is viewed and how God is viewed. First Peter 3. 1 Peter 3, okay, likewise, ye wives, be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they also may be without the word, be won by the conversation of the wives. Okay, this is crucial here. You can actually win your husband if he's not born again, just by your behavior. Okay, while they behold your chaste conversation coupled with fear, okay, who's adorning... Now, this is speaking of the chaste conversation. He's going to give descriptive here. Who's adorning, let it not be that outward adorning of plaiting the hair and wearing of gold and of putting on of apparel, but let it be of the hidden man of the heart, in that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which in the sight of God is of a great price. Okay, for after this manner, in the old time, the holy women also, who trusted in God, adorned themselves, being in subjection unto their own husbands. Even as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters are ye, as long as ye do well, and not afraid with any amazement. All right. So, one, is he saying here that you can't put on makeup and do your hair and that kind of stuff? Or have nice clothing? No, he's just making a contrast, basically. He says it in Timothy as well. Your focus should be on who you are as a person, and not what you look like. Okay, so in other words, God's priority and what makes you of great price and valuable in God's eyes, yes, it's because of your soul, you know, what Christ has invested in you. He saved your soul. Okay, he came to seek and save that which was lost, so he wanted you because the fact is you're an eternal soul created in his image. But it's your inner person, your inner man. It's who you are, your character, your integrity, how your value system, how you carry yourself. And so instead of focusing, and that's not to say that you can't look pretty or you can't do those, you know, that stuff. There's nothing wrong with that stuff. But the thing is, your focus and attention, he says here, let it be that of the hidden man of the heart, that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit. And the thing is, people see that. People notice that more than anything else. There's a proverb that as a golden earring in the swine and swine's snout, so is a fair woman without discretion. So in other words, with that saying, it's kind of like seeing fancy jewelry on a pig. To see a woman that is, you would consider like physically attractive, or even have some sort of attractiveness to her, but doesn't have discretion. In other words, she's not using her mind wisely. She's not using her mind for the Lord. She's not living for God. Proverbs 31, you know, favor is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised. In other words, favor is deceitful. Okay, favor there has to do with like your graciousness. Like, you can have a person that has a very pleasant disposition. The way they communicate, the way they carry themselves is very, you know, nice and professional and even really sweet. And beauty, the word vain there has the idea of it's transitory. It's here today, gone tomorrow. It's kind of like in James, where it talks about that our life is even a vapor, right? When you're boiling eggs or you're boiling something on a pot, on the stove, that you see the vapor come up. And then just as soon as it's up, it's almost as, you know, gone just as quick. Okay, so your physical beauty, the fact is, and I know a lot of times we value it, but the fact is it's here today, gone tomorrow. But what we would value a lot of times as humans, we look to that, but God says, you know, it's the woman that fears God. So it's her, it's the woman's heart that has a heart that says, look, I'm going to be what God wants. I want God's will. I want God to be magnified. And that is of great value to God. And that is what is different or stands out between the woman that fears God or the godly woman. And somebody that you know, you can have the Miss Universe, Miss America, Miss whatever, you know, contestant or pageant winner and that kind of stuff. And, you know, they may be physically beautiful and they may even be a sweet, genuine person and all that, but do they fear God? You know, do they have a heart that says, that cries out for the Lord? And so if we're gonna, okay, as far as women in particular, they're created to be caregiver and they're created to be a helper suitable. Now, in fulfilling that, mind you, we read in 1 Corinthians, you can still fulfill that in service to the Lord as a single person, so you don't necessarily have to be, even though God's original intent and design was for marriage, but the fact is, not everybody, obviously one, not everybody marries, and then two, it may not be God's will for everybody to marry. He's created some, the Bible talks about in Matthew as far as that he's created, there were some eunuchs that were made of men, and then some that committed themselves, they made themselves eunuchs. And so that's whatever, that's something that you would have to be before the Lord, you decide and follow his leading on that. But as a single person, you still are able to go ahead and fulfill God's role for you as someone, primarily if you pursue God, if you have a heart for the Lord. All right, does anybody have any questions? Wow, okay, no. All right, we're gonna be looking at the men's, particularly next week, as far as what the Bible has to say with regard to him, and as far as being, and then we're also gonna look at the way that the book lays it out here is you, how you display your gender, which we've covered some of that already here. All right, no questions. Okay, we're gonna be looking at the men's next week, and then we should wrap up after that. All right, no questions, we're dismissing.
Fantastic.
What's that?
That's a fantastic.